On the 23rd of February 2019, crowds gathered outside the National Stadium for what would be a historic victory for Wales over the old foe, England. For the Welsh, it's a rivalry like no other.
In 1977, Welsh rugby captain Phil Bennett is said to have inspired his teammates with this pre-match speech.
Look what these bastards have done to Wales. They've taken our coal, our water, our steel. They buy our homes and only live in them for a fortnight every year. What have they given us? Absolutely nothing. We've been exploited and punished by the English. And that's who you're playing this afternoon.
If you want to raise the passion of the Welsh, mentioning England is always a good bet. But it doesn't just inspire rugby players. Our relationship with England has been central to the whole course of Welsh history. It shaped who we are.
I'm Martin Johns, a professor of history at Swansea University.
There are those who see this as the single most important aspect of 20th century history.
And I'm heading out across Wales to re-examine our history, to explore the evidence, re-enter the past.
You're the brave Celt about to attack Mercia. I'm a Mercian soldier, right? I'm standing on the very top of my bank here.
And meet some leading historians with some controversial opinions.
Welsh status was viewed almost like a form of contagion.
I'm exploring centuries of cooperation, conquest, oppression, and even colonization. To start my journey, I'm heading up into the clouds and to a place that's personal to me.
My fascination with the past started in this landscape. I even used to scramble up here to do some A-level history revision. I'm not sure I'd do that now.
This is Foel Drygan in Pembrokeshire, an Iron Age fort and the starting point of this story. When this was built over 2,000 years ago, people didn't think of themselves as Welsh. We don't know what they call themselves, but now we label them the Celts.
The whole concept of Wales doesn't exist until people who lived in places like this encounter someone different. Today, we call them the English.
Once, the Celts lived across most of Britain. But from the 5th century, slowly but steadily, the Anglo-Saxons move across the island, changing Britain forever.
The Anglo-Saxons push west, but they stop. They don't reach the peninsula we now call Wales in any great numbers. A new border is created. A boundary between two cultures, two languages, two peoples.
It's been eroded by over 1,000 years of Welsh weather, but it's still clear to see. Offa's Dyke, named after the Anglo-Saxon king of Mercia, has been held up as proof of a great battle, a wall to divide warring people.
It's a ditch and a bank. Maybe not the most formidable military fortification you've ever seen, but what's impressive about its scale is not its height, but its length. It ran, said one 9th century source, from sea to sea, from north to south.
Dr. Alex Langland is an expert in early medieval archaeology and has his own views on why the wall was built.
To me, this is a military fortification. This is, they didn't get far enough that way, and they're defending their lands against the Welsh, against the Britons over there.
There's going to have been battles, Martin. It's the medieval period. That's what happens in the medieval period. But in fact, when we look at the dike, all 240 kilometres of it doesn't actually make sense as a defensive monument. If you come up here though, Martin, you'll get a really good sense of this landscape. Okay, now look at this hill here. Okay, if we actually look, our dike is running this way. The hill, okay, it's higher up on that side than it is to the east. Yeah. So if this was really a defensive monument, you would want to crown the hill. In fact, you're uphill there. So a good charge, bunch of horses at the monument here, you'd have the momentum to punch through quite easily. Okay, so this really isn't a defensive monument.
So if it's not defensive, what is it then?
Well, this is all about, by the time we get to the 8th century, okay, the Anglo-Saxons are starting to style themselves in kind of very imperial ways. Actually, what you're looking to do is to get all of your own men to do allegiance to you. It's all about you being on top and everyone doing service to you. And the service they're doing in this case is they're all coming and helping to build this monument for the great King Offa.
Alex believes that the 240-kilometre dike took 48,000 people to build. It was a grand display of absolute authority from King Offa, a statement of power. But more than that, it created a border.
This earthen mound, built 1,200 or so years ago, it shut the people to the west off from the people to the east. It created a distinct territory. And in that process lies the origins of the creation of modern Wales.
Today, the border between England and Wales is surprisingly close to the line taken by the dike. And the people on both sides of it were changing how they thought of themselves. The Anglo-Saxon kingdoms came together to form England, and the English had a name for the people on the other side of the border. They call themselves the Cymru, fellow countrymen, but the English call them foreigner or outsider. Their word was Waelas, Wales. The Anglo-Saxons did something else for us too. The Welsh were divided into kingdoms, but they were united by the anger of being a people pushed to the margins. The earliest evidence is kept in the National Library in Aberystwyth. Curator Dr. Meredith Ap Hugh keeps the ancient manuscript.
So what are we looking at here then?
Well, the 14th century Book of Taliesin includes a number of poems which were really written back in what we would think of today as the Dark Ages. Among those poems being Armes Prydain Fawr, the great prophecy of Britain.
It's actually really beautiful. That's proper craftsmanship writing that. And is this the only place this poem is written down?
There may have been other versions written during the medieval period, but this is the only one that has survived. And here's the beginning of the poem. Di gogan awen dy gobrysyn, maraned a meied a hed genin, a phennaeth e helaeth, a fraeth unbyn, a gwedi dyched anhed ym mhob mechyn, gwir gwychyr yn trydar, casnar degin.
So what's the poem about then?
The poem is all about an alliance between the peoples of the western seaboard of Britain against the High King of the English, who's increasing his power over the Welsh people. The hope is in the poem that the English are not just subjugated, oh no, but they are actually to be expelled from England, so that Britain returns to the rightful owners, who are, of course, the British, who are, of course, Welsh.
There seems to be a common theme in these books that in the future someone will come to deliver the Welsh from their oppression.
That person is a hero in these poems, coming from the early Welsh tradition. By the late medieval period, of course, these figures are replaced by a Mab Darogan.
Mab Darogan, son of prophecy, a figure that will someday lead the Welsh to victory against the English.
It's an idea that recurs down the centuries, calling the Welsh to battle, giving them hope that one day the English will be defeated.
People begin looking for the one that will lead them. Stories are told about Arthur and Cadwallader, legendary figures who had fought the Saxons and would someday rise up to do so again. The hope for the Mab Drogan will recur through time, helping to define the relationship between England and Wales. This island had been invaded and settled before. Romans and Vikings both left their mark, but the Anglo-Saxons created England, and in doing so helped create Wales. This change was permanent. The shifting fortunes, whims, and demands of England would affect the people of Wales for many generations. In 1066, a new chapter in the relationship between England and Wales began. The Battle of Hastings saw England fall to a Norman invasion, and it wasn't long before they embarked on a bloody conquest of parts of Wales. The Welsh were used to fighting amongst themselves and against the English, but the Normans were a new, superior enemy with new, superior approaches to battle. Within a year or so, the Normans have crossed the border. To find out how the invaders forced their way into Wales, I've come to Newtown in Powys to meet Mark Griffin, an expert in medieval weaponry.
So when the Welsh first encounter the Normans in the late 11th century, is it a clash of technologies as well?
The Normans are certainly more advanced, but they've got this whole machine. They've got more materials that they can bring to bear. So your Welsh soldier, his head protection, maybe he's got a leather helmet, whereas the Normans have got these wonderful metal ones. The Welsh soldier will be equipped with some padded armour, linen, maybe leather again. But over the top of that, the Norman is going to be able to have a lot more of this sort of stuff, the mail shirt that's all the little interlinks, protective against anything that's going to slash him. So really effective.
And actually surprisingly light, given what it is.
Yes, and with all this on, you're far more confident as well.
And there was something else that gave the Normans a critical advantage, something that was still unusual on Welsh battlefields in the 11th and 12th centuries.
They've got horses, the fact that they've got their cavalry equipped with these fearsome lances that they can use in shock cavalry tactics. And once you get the shield on, you've got your lance here. So you're coming in and you can press into your enemy with your shield and your horse, and then you can bring your lance to bear as well. The Welsh, they're adopting more hit and run tactics. They're more guerrilla warfare, basically. But they're using simple weapons. They're using spears. They're using axes. They're almost using farm implements, whatever they can bring to bear. The Normans are bigger and stronger. They've got far more materials they can bring to bear. But also, they've got some fantastic skilled craftsmen. If you look at this beautiful 11th, 12th century sword. There you go, have a feel of that. And it's
surprisingly
sharp.
Light.
It's light, it's flexible. The advance in technology between your average Welshman pulling an axe or some farming implement off the wall to go and defend his home, to this, which is specifically made as a weapon of war to be used by a trained soldier, is quite a big leap. You know, that's almost space age technology. Yeah.
This technology was really designed for one purpose, to maim and kill. It was clear that the Normans were a formidable opponent. These innovative weapons sent shockwaves through Wales, but there was something else too.
Very quickly, it's apparent that the Normans are here to stay. They're not just changing the political landscape, they're changing the physical landscape too. Building castles like this one here, great earthen mounds crowned with a wooden tower, staking their claim, their hold on the land around it.
These were the first Norman castles built in Wales. It might not look like a castle now, but once there was a wooden fortress at the summit. And it was from these castles that the Normans controlled the land and the people. These mounds were military and political centres for conquest. Having come this far, it'd be a shame not to get a closer look.
A thousand years on, it's still here. But the fact it's still here shows that these castles changed Wales forever. They were a permanent mark on the landscape. They were a sign that power was shifting.
Eventually, these wooden fortresses were replaced with stone structures so impressive, they still stir the imagination. Today, they pull in tourists, but then they were there to control a people being conquered. They established a new relationship between the Welsh and the people over the border. This is Pembroke Castle, one of the biggest in the south. It's not just a defensive fortress, it's a statement of power. The Normans are rewriting the rules of conflict in Wales. This isn't just a military clash, it's a clash of cultures. Traditionally, the Welsh had paid communal fines when they'd rebelled, but the Normans had a different set of rules. They took prisoners, or even executed those who stood up against them. We don't have to guess what the people of Wales felt about the men inside the great castles appearing in their landscape. In the 11th century, a Welsh priest wrote this.
The people and priests are despised by the word, heart and deeds of the Frenchmen. They burden us with tribute and consume our possessions. One of them, however lowly, shakes 100 natives with his command and terrifies them with his look. Alas our fall, alas our deep grief. The Normans didn't just build castles, they introduced monasteries too that controlled and taxed the local population, making them as much instruments of conquest as any fortress.
In Pembrokeshire, there's another dimension to Norman conquest.
In an act of colonialism, they implanted a new population of foreign English and Flemish peasants intended to civilise the Welsh landscape.
New people with a new language brought new place names. The legacy of conquest here is still evident today.
The scale of the colonisation around here is clear when you look at a map. The place names are all in English. Winter Hall, Strawberry Hill Farm, Upper Nash, Welston, Milton. The Welsh have literally been wiped off the map.
Conquest and colonisation were bound to create a deep sense of injustice, anger and resentment.
The Normans didn't just have it their own way. The monk Gerald of Wales said the Welsh were a people who were happy to die in battle, but thought it a disgrace to die in bed.
Rebellions were inevitable.
Gerald also tells us about Gwenllian Ferch Gruffydd, a Welsh noblewoman who led men into battle.
It's winter, 1136. Across Wales, the Welsh are rebelling. Gwenllian's husband, a prince in the south, is gathering support for a battle, and the Normans seize the moment to strike back.
With the Normans rallying against rebellion and her husband away, Gwenllian takes matters into her own hand, gathers a force, and prepares a counterattack.
Gerald of Wales records, the Princess Gwenllian rode forward at the head of an army, like the Queen of the Amazons.
Somewhere near here, at Cydweli Castle, Gwenllian's force clashes with the Normans.
There's a battle. The Welsh forces attack the Normans, but the Normans rout the rebellion.
Gwenllian is killed, and some say her death inspired the rebellion to carry on. The truth is, as with so much of medieval history, we just don't know. And that's especially so when it comes to the role of women.
Historian Dr. Emma Cavell has looked at the role of women in the medieval period and why that role has tended to be overlooked.
Gwenllian's story seems to stand out. Why don't we know more about women in medieval Wales?
Well, two reasons, really. One is that the people who wrote history at the time, the chroniclers, who were normally monks, are not as interested in what the women are doing, unless they do something particularly outstanding or transgressive. And the second one is that modern historians tend to be very little interested in the women.
And if historians did look back, would they find a man's world?
Yes and no. I mean, in the way that, say, today could still be seen as a man's world, it is very male-oriented, very much a sort of warrior society. But what we don't tend to realise is women are a very important part of that society. They are involved in spying, in diplomacy, in arranging the marriages, in integrating Wales into English polity. And even on a day-to-day basis, they're not in the window doing their needlework, as one might think.
This is a story of shifting power, a story of kings and princes. But crucially, it's also the story of the ordinary people who live through it, the men and the women. Over the next century, the invading people stopped thinking of themselves as Normans and became the new English. Wales is divided into kingdoms. The south, partly occupied by the invaders, but Powys and Gwynedd in the north remain in the hands of powerful and ambitious Welsh princes. This is Snowdonia. Today, it attracts people to the north, but for medieval Wales, it was a natural fortress keeping the English out. The rugged, inhospitable landscape played in favour of a defending people. People could use the mountains to provide lookout points, positions to attack from, and places to hide. 800 years ago, this was, for any invading army, an impenetrable place. And it added to the sense of Wales and the Welsh as a wild place, a wild people. And the Normans could justify what they were doing. They were bringing civilization to untamed land. But these people were anything but untamed. Gwynedd was home to the most powerful of the Welsh princes, including Llywelyn Fawr, Llywelyn the Great, perhaps the most respected and successful of all Welsh rulers. Llywelyn Fawr called himself the Lord of Snowdonia. And that's because this was the heart of his Gwynedd, the heart of what was left of independent Wales. Today, Wales is a nation in many ways based on the south, centred on Cardiff. But in the 13th century, it was the north that mattered. It was the north that was at the centre of Welsh power. Recently, a four-year project has brought to life the status and authority of the princes of Gwynedd. And the work has resulted in this, a new building at St Fagans, the National Museum of Wales. I'm meeting Dr. Mark Redknapp, the man behind the recreation.
So, this is an impressive building. What are we looking at here?
We're standing in the courtyard of an archaeological reconstruction of a Welsh lys for the Kingdom of Gwynedd, based on the excavations by the Gwynedd Archaeological Trust in the 1990s of a real lys site.
A lys is a court and a royal palace. To tap into the secrets of one of the most powerful men in Welsh history, Mark and his team used archaeological remains on Anglesey and then added a little imagination. From that, they reconstructed a centre of Welsh princely power.
Do you
you think Llywelyn would recognise this building?
That is a very good question. I would think that he might recognise elements of it.
The building has just been opened, and I'm one of the first to enter the world of the Welsh princes.
So immediately this building speaks of authority, of power.
That's right. The overall message is very much, from Llywelyn's perspective, I'm an equal with you if you're a ruler, for example. And that message would be conveyed to anybody coming to the court. Behind the throne, he has the heraldry of the arms of the Princess of Gwynedd, the heraldic arms, which are four lions.
And is he making this statement of power to people beneath him in Gwynedd and North Wales, or is he speaking also to the English crown?
He's saying that to anybody who comes to court. One can imagine Llywelyn coming here at least once a year and conducting judicial functions, administration, you know, business of the realm, if you like.
A powerful and confident prince is faced with an invading people inching ever closer. Wales is divided and riven with infighting.
In the face of the English might on his doorstep, Llywelyn needs to establish a power base. He needs to assert his authority over the other rulers of what's left of independent Wales. So he builds new castles, he establishes new taxes, he even abandons the Welsh tradition of dividing your inheritance equally between all your sons. In essence, to ensure the survival of Wales, he's copying the English.
But Llywelyn's vision of creating a strong power base is short-lived. After his death in 1240, Gwynedd descends into civil war. The dream of an independent Wales is lost until his grandson takes up the cause, a man we now know as Llywelyn the Last.
Llywelyn's ambitions go further than his grandfather. He wanted to be recognised as Prince of Wales. And recognition can only really come from one place, the English crown.
Much of King Henry III's reign is spent keeping ambitious barons in England under control. He doesn't need distractions in Wales. To stop further threats from Gwynedd, he's willing to go along with Llywelyn's plans.
But there's going to be a condition. Llywelyn is going to have to pay, and it's going to be expensive.
For 25,000 marks, the king agrees to recognise Llywelyn as the Prince of Wales.
So here we have the most powerful prince in the history of independent Wales. But what makes him Prince of Wales? The stamp of approval of the English king. Even at the height of our independence, it's still clear where power really lies.
And any pretense of power that Llywelyn might have comes quickly crashing down when the king dies and is succeeded by his son, Edward I. Edward is a crusader, a soldier, and a brutal king who expelled the Jews from England and would go to war with both the Welsh and the Scots. But Llywelyn isn't just looking east to England. All around him is the sea, and that connects him to Europe and the world.
Ideas, people are moving in and out of Gwynedd. It's tempting to describe Llywelyn's Wales as an emerging European nation.
In his own mind, the new Prince of Wales is part of a network of European royalty, perhaps even equal to the English king. But Llywelyn's ambitions create a dilemma. This is Abergwyn Gregin on the Menai Straits. In the 14th century, this was Llywelyn's seat of power.
A new title raises new questions. How much power does the Prince of Wales have? Where exactly is his principality? The emerging answers don't satisfy Llywelyn.
Then things get worse. To clarify where power really lies, the English king asked the Welsh prince to come and pay homage to him. To do this would be a public acceptance that the English king is superior to the Welsh prince. Llywelyn may have already conceded that by paying for his title, but for some reason, he won't do it again. It's a grand snub, and Edward doesn't stand for it.
Llywelyn has overplayed his hand. Edward loses patience. He prepares a huge army to invade Gwynedd.
In July 1277, Edward sends the English army into Wales. It's a vast and unstoppable power.
Llywelyn is defeated. He's forced into submission. He's forced to giving up much of his land. But he does get to keep his title. But it's a title without power. It's only to last for his lifetime. The last of independent Wales stands on a precipice.
Edward builds castles and pays for them with crippling taxes on the Welsh. There's anger, but Llywelyn holds back from leading his people, and it's his brother Dafydd that starts a rebellion. When Llywelyn's wife dies in childbirth, he finally decides to take action.
Perhaps he has nothing left to lose. He joins his brother in the rebellion. He leads the Welsh in their fight against English oppression.
Llywelyn draws an army together and leads them south to gather support for a battle with England. A battle for the future of independent Wales. They get as far as Kilmeri, and this is where his story ends.
What happens isn't clear. For some reason, Llywelyn is separated from the rest of his army. There's no grand battle, just a skirmish, maybe even an ambush. Some say the English soldiers facing him didn't even know who he was. But whatever happens, Llywelyn is killed, and with him fades the dream of an independent Wales. Llywelyn's head is cut off. Legend says it was washed here. What is certain is that it's sent to London to the king. It's stuck on a spike at the Tower of London and left for all to see. A warning of what happens to those who defy the king.
Dafydd, the brother of Llywelyn, is captured by the English and becomes the first nobleman to be hanged, drawn and quartered. Gwynedd is defeated, and the last of Wales has been conquered by England. Edward I assumes control, and in a final act of vengeance, he attempts to destroy any further hopes of another native Prince of Wales.
Edward doesn't just take Llywelyn's head, his land, his nation, he takes his title too. The story goes that Edward promised the people of Wales that he'd give them a prince that spoke not a word of English. And what does he do? He makes his newborn son Prince of Wales. The story's probably not true, but it captures the bitterness that to the present day, the heir to the English throne is known as the Prince of Wales.
More than 700 years later, and the story still echoes in the present day. Once a year, people still meet here. For some, Llywelyn's story is a rallying point, a reminder of a time before English rule, and perhaps a call to arms. But others prefer to forget. This is, after all, a tale of defeat and loss, the end of independence. The cause was English power, but Llywelyn's mistakes played a part too. He misjudged his opponent and played the game of politics badly.
These stories of people from long ago, we don't really know the individuals. We can't be sure of what really happened, but they do matter. They're part of who we are. The part of what makes Wales what it is. They don't all have happy endings, but in many ways, the tragedy is they're not better known.
However you choose to interpret the past, It seems to me you have to start by knowing the past, our own past.
This is BBC Radio Wales.
We do have some mist and fog to start the day in Powys, with the best of the brightness along the north coast. All the while, cloud is thickening from the southwest, with heavy rain pushing in and reaching most areas by lunchtime. But we can look forward to something drier and brighter for the south and west mid-afternoon. Highs of 8 to 11 Celsius. We do have gusty south to southwesterly winds today.
We think of medieval Wales as being about politics and princes, but weather like this reminds you it must have also been a struggle against nature. Sometimes it probably didn't matter who was in charge.
But Edward isn't taking any chances. He's conquered Wales and he isn't going to lose it. Edward builds and captures castles around Gwynedd. It's an iron ring around Snowdonia, the stronghold of the most powerful Welsh princes. The legacy of this is that to this day, there are more castles per square mile in Wales than anywhere else in the world.
This is Caernarfon, the greatest of all Edward's castles, and a new walled town, a colonial settlement for the conquerors, a settlement that the Welsh were excluded from.
Edward engaged in a full-scale project of military conquest. The towns and the castles were the engines of his occupation. And today, they're tourist attractions.
How should we feel about these castles? They are, after all, symbols of defeat and conquest. And there are some that resent them for that. But they are amazing historical buildings. They're amongst the greatest historical monuments in the world, I'd say. And for those who do resent them, maybe they can take solace in one thing. They show that Edward took the Welsh seriously.
He taxes them harshly too, and this leads them to rebel again in 1294. This time, Edward goes further. The Welsh lose some of their legal rights. They are no longer allowed to live in the new towns being built in their own country. Dr. Matthew Stevens is a historian of medieval law.
Thousands of acres of land near Denbigh were cleared of their Welsh farmers who were moved into the uplands, where a lot of them suffered real deprivation, possibly starvation. And in fact, Welsh status was viewed almost like a form of contagion. For example, if you were an English person and you married a Welsh person, you became Welsh.
So we have a situation where the Welsh don't have the same legal rights as the English. They're paying different taxes. They have a different cultural status. It sounds to me rather like apartheid.
It's a strong word, apartheid, but it's maybe not a bad way to think of it, you know, to put it in a modern mindset. You have a minority role who are privileged economically and socially, but the majority of persons in Wales, by comparison to English neighbours, really were second-class citizens.
Military conquest, race laws, settler plantations. Colonisation is an uncomfortable word, but it's difficult to think of a better one to describe what happened to so much of Wales after Edward's victory. We're often told that in Britain we need to face up to our history of empire, to understand the subjugation and exploitation we inflicted on so much of the world. And that's right, that is important. But it's also important to understand that before there was a British empire, there was an English empire. Wales was England's first colony. And just as the British Empire helps explain so much of the inequality that exists across the globe, the English Empire, the conquest of Wales, helps explain why the United Kingdom is not a union of equals. The English regime was to continue for more than a century without any serious challenge from the Welsh. Edward's iron ring and the might of the English army prevent any rebellion. That is until a new leader,
capable of inspiring a widespread Welsh uprising, emerges.
The second half of the 14th century is an age of turmoil. The Black Death has turned the economy upside down. It's an era when across Europe there's political instability. It's a time when small things can escalate out of control. And that seems to be what happens to a small landowner from North Wales. A man who's been loyal to the English system, a man who's fought in the English army. But something happens to turn him into the leader of a national uprising.
When the resentment to English rule explodes, Owain Glyndŵr is at his head.
Glyndŵr wages a guerrilla war, attacking the symbols of English power, burning, raiding, pillaging, the English retaliate in kind, and soon Wales descends into a pit of ethnic warfare. In a divisive age, Glyndŵr is a divisive figure. For the English, and some of the Welsh too, he's a rebel, an outlaw. But for the rest of Wales, he's a hero. A Mab Darogan, the son of prophecy, a new Arthur who's going to lead Wales and the Welsh back to their freedom and their liberties. On the 22nd of June, 1402, two armies meet here at Bryn Glas in Powys. Glyndŵr's rebellion is becoming a war. On one side, the army of Sir Edmund Mortimer, an English Marcher Lord, and on the other, the army of Owain Glyndŵr. Sir Edmund has maybe 2,000 troops. Glyndŵr's army is much smaller, but they have the high ground. It seems a crazy tactic, but Mortimer's men charge up this hill towards Glyndŵr's army at the top. They must have been charging into a rainstorm of arrows. And inside Mortimer's army are a group of Welsh bowmen. And for whatever reason, maybe it was pre-planned, they change sides. And in doing so, they seal Glyndŵr's victory. It's a beautiful, peaceful landscape now. But as night fell on the battle, it must have been a gruesome sight. One English chronicler described what he thought had happened. The Welsh women cut off the genitalia of the dead, put the member of each dead man in his mouth and hung his testicles from his chin.
It's a graphic account that is still shocking 600 years later. But it was meant to be. It was written to get a reaction. That is an English account calculated to stir up hatred of the Welsh. England and Wales are at war. Glyndŵr's war burns towns and crops. Many must have been killed. There are victims on both sides. This is a rebellion for freedom, but it's the people that suffer. The English respond to the violence by extending and intensifying the apartheid laws across Wales.
In 1404, Owain Glyndŵr takes this, Harlech Castle.
It's both a symbolic and a strategically significant victory.
It's another sign that this is more than a guerrilla war. It's a war for independence.
Glyndŵr moves here with his family and grows his dream of an independent Wales, a country free of English rule, with its own parliament and its own universities. He's becoming a statesman too. He secures English allies keen to use Glyndŵr to help them in their struggles against the king. He negotiates with France and Scotland. A vision of a modern nation is emerging, with Glyndŵr as its prince. And this is what future generations will remember. Not the violence of Glyndŵr's rebellion, but its vision. Glyndŵr is an inspirational leader, but the English have a strong leader too.
Henry V, one of the great warrior kings of the Middle Ages, learned his trade here in Wales. As a young prince, he leads an English army into Wales to hunt down Glyndŵr and crush his rebellion. Things come to a head here. Owain is trapped inside. Outside is the future king and his army, laying siege to the castle. It's Glyndŵr's last stand. Owain, his family, his men, they're stuck. There's an army at their gates trying to starve them out. They must be desperate. The castle is taken. Owain's wife and children are captured. His rebellion is over. It would be the last time the Welsh rise up militarily against English rule. The crown offers reconciliation, but the apartheid laws are not repealed. Rebels who fail to submit are hanged. Resentment simmers. The rebellion is over, but Glyndŵr hasn't been captured. At some point during the siege of Harlech Castle, he slips off, he escapes. Now, leaving your wife and kids behind doesn't sound very heroic, but his escape allows his legend to grow. For the believers, the hope lives on. After the defeat of Glyndŵr, Wales faces a devastated landscape, a ruined economy, and a set of apartheid laws, which even if not always implemented, were more draconian than those of Edward I. The first steps towards equality between the Welsh and the English would come from a surprising source. For 7 decades, English kings come and go, while little changes for ordinary people in Wales. But the beginning of Wales's liberation came from one of the most fascinating, glamorous, dangerous dynasties ever to sit on the English throne, the Tudors. Henry Tudor was born here at Pembroke Castle and came to know the coastline of the West. Though he was not in line to be king, Henry could trace a link to the crown through his mother's family, a fragile link that gave him ambition. Henry's claim to the throne was, well, tenuous at best, but the machinations of English politics gave him a chance to win a kingdom. He just needed to take it. His chance came when he was 27. Exiled in France, he rallied support for his claim to the English throne. But he needed more soldiers to take on the might of the king. Henry would turn to the Welsh. He'd land on a secluded beach close to the castle where he was born, Mill Bay in Pembrokeshire. It's hard to imagine it now, but this is the beach where, in 1485, Henry VII and his small army landed, ready to make his assault on the throne. His hope was that he could appeal to the Welsh as an oppressed people, that he could inspire them to join with him, to take on the English army, and to bring down an English king. The Welsh poets would see hope in Henry too. They were putting the word around that Henry Tudor was Mab Drogan, the son of prophecy, the one who was going to come and liberate the Welsh from their oppression. Henry would harness centuries of Welsh anger against the English. He raised the flag of Cadwaladr, emblazoned with the red dragon, the flag of the king who'd fought against the Saxons. It was a hard call to resist. Here was a man who was going to liberate the Welsh. Henry sets out on a march through Wales, stopping in towns and villages to appeal to the Welsh to follow him into war with England. It's a march that ends in a field in Bosworth and a battle with the English army, led in person by King Richard III. In 3 hours of brutal battle, Richard is thrown from his horse
and is said to have been killed by a Welsh foot soldier.
Richard III loses his life, Henry gains a crown, and a man that Wales claims as one of its own is King of England.
A new dynasty is on the throne, the Tudors. But despite all the promise, in Wales, little actually changes, and resentment simmers and grows. Discontented subjects are always dangerous. It's Henry's son, Henry VIII, who decides to secure his realm against rebellion and deal with Wales. He brings in laws that would change Wales forever.
What's now known as the Acts of Union are introduced. In effect, they make Wales part of England.
Henry wants to do away with differences between his people, to make his kingdom one. And this means assimilating Wales, ending its position as a separate nation.
Many today see this as the devastating climax of conquest. Politically, Wales was no more. But that's just not how the Welsh at the time saw it.
If England and Wales were one and the same, then so were the people. For centuries, ordinary people in Wales had lived under a kind of apartheid, second-class citizens in their own country.
The Acts of Union had given the Welsh back their rights. This was something to celebrate. In the eyes of the law, English and Welsh were equal again. The system that had resembled apartheid was over.
Changing the law was one thing, but Henry's attempt to unify his people went further. All officers and ministers of the law shall keep the courts in the English tongue, and no persons that use the Welsh language shall have office or fees within this realm. The Welsh may have gained their freedoms, but the price was their status as a different country. And English was now set in law as the language of officialdom. These would have effects that lasted for centuries. But what mattered most at the time was not matters of nationhood, but of faith. This Welsh church has been painstakingly restored to the time early in the reign of Henry VIII, under advice from historian Professor Madeline Gray.
Lovely to see you.
Come and see my church.
I'd love to.
It contains the secrets of what happened next.
It is an impressive building, isn't it?
It's amazing, isn't it? And it was just a little parish church down in the valley of the Lugher. It was virtually derelict. Someone nicked the roof. Mm-hmm. The rain got in, washed the whitewash off the walls, and they found these amazing medieval wall paintings.
The old church is entirely decorated with huge paintings.
One of the amazing things about the church is the amount of text there was as part of the wall paintings.
But what is striking is that all of the text is in Latin, the language of the church which few understood.
So we're talking about an era when all the services would have been in Latin?
Virtually everything, yes. A little bit of the prayers in the local language, which here would have been Welsh, but virtually everything in Latin.
Henry had split from the church in Rome, making himself head of the church in England. As a result, the country was violently divided for generations. To win the people over from Catholicism, Henry's daughter, Elizabeth I, sanctions that the Latin prayer book and Bible be translated into the language the people spoke, Welsh. The crown orders that a Welsh Bible is placed in every parish church.
Under Elizabeth, the realisation that if you're going to keep the Welsh on board, you've got to do it in our own language. So you get the prayer book translated into Welsh, you get the New Testament, the new part of the Bible translated into Welsh, and then in 1588, you get the whole thing.
It was an act calculated to win the hearts of the Welsh, but it did something else too.
By having the services of the church in people's own language, it was there for the big events of your life. Marriage, children, bereavement. The prayer book is always there saying the words that you can't quite manage yourself. And then there's the translation of the Bible, which makes Welsh into a modern literary language.
So can we go as far as saying that the translation of the prayer book and the Bible saved the Welsh language?
I think between them they did. I think there is a case for saying that the prayer book was, if anything, more important than the Bible.
The same dynasty that made English the language of officialdom made Welsh a language of religion. This is Llandaf Cathedral. William Morgan was a bishop here, but in 1588, he was the man who translated the Bible into Welsh.
In the 16th century, there were royal proclamations, court edicts, but the highest authority was God. Latin had always been the language of religion, ond nawr roedd bobl gallu clywed Duw yn yr iaith Gymraeg. Now, people could hear God in their own language.
The state had never intended to raise the status of Welsh, but that's precisely what happened. This helped save the language, but it also tied Wales further to England, with the Welsh allowed to pray in their own tongue. Why rebel?
The dynasty that tried to abolish Welsh nationhood by enforcing a union on Wales also gave the Welsh back their rights, giving them equal legal status with the English. They also gave the Welsh the word of God in their own language, giving Welsh a status that helped it survive through the centuries. Love them or hate them, the Tudors have helped shape the course of Welsh history.
We were conquered and colonised. Maybe it's easy to be angry, but it was a long time ago. And to dwell on the losses creates the idea of Wales as a victim, unable to act for itself. Instead, we should look at the other thing that medieval history teaches us, that Welshness can survive against the odds. We're resilient, not powerless. But whatever lesson we take from it, our early history still shapes us.
It left us with a distinct territory. It gave us a name. It gave us heroes and hopes. Hopes for Mab Darogan, a son of prophecy, someone who would rise up and lead us to freedom against the English. But more than that, it left us with a sense of difference, a sense that Wales is not England.
Next time, how much power has England had over Wales in the recent past?
But of all the inhabitants of 10 Downing Street, only one has been unequivocally and defiantly Welsh.
How have we been shaped by England over the last two centuries? And what does it mean for the future of Wales?